Greetings, everyone. I am Mohammed Tabakuli, and as the director of the newly established Elahé Omidyar Mir-Djalali Institute of Iranian Studies, I welcome you all to our weekly webinar series focusing on the twin topics of women poets and Iranian cinema. Beginning with today's session, our webinar series will be called Elahé Omidyar Mir-Djalali Lecture Series. This series is sponsored by the Department of History, Historical Studies, Near and Middle Eastern Civilizations, Women, Gender and Sexuality Studies, UTM, the Cinema Studies Institute, the Center for Comparative Literature and Critical Studies in Equity and Solidarity at the University of Toronto. The lecture series is also sponsored by the Department of History at York University and the Department of English at Ryerson University. It is also sponsored by Iran Namag, a quarterly study of Iranian studies. I am grateful for the support of all these units at the University of Toronto and other institutions at the in Toronto. I'm also thankful to colleagues, Professor Victoria Tahmasbi, Professor Shahzad Mojab, Leila Purtabaf, Nima Naqibi, Khatere Shaybani, Gulbarg Kaptalai, Sara Saljougi, Azita Talaghani, Mahdi Walizade, Jairan Gahan, Reza Tahir Kermani, and Arshavez Muzaffari for their invaluable support of our Iranian poets, women poets, and cinema. I would like to also express my gratitude to Canada's Indigenous people and acknowledge this land on which the University of Toronto operates. For thousands of years, it has been the traditional land of the Huron Wendat, the Seneca, and most recently, the Mississaugas of the Credit River. Today, this meeting place is still the home of many Indigenous people from Turtle Island, and we are grateful to have the opportunity to work on this land. It is a great pleasure to welcome Professor Shahzad Shams Ismaili, our speaker today, to the University of Toronto. My colleague, Professor Jairan Gahan of University of Alberta, will introduce Professor Shams and moderate today's session. Professor Gahan, all yours.
Thank you, Dr. Tawakwili. And thank you for your really beautiful land acknowledgement. I will not repeat it, but I really appreciate your land acknowledgement. I will not take a lot of time. I will very briefly just introduce Dr. Fatemeh Shams and then hand over the table to her. So Dr. Fatemeh Shams is a specialist in Persian literature. She earned her PhD in Oriental Studies from University of Oxford, Wadham College. Before joining Penn, she has taught Persian language and literature in various academic institutions, including University of Oxford, University of SOAS, and Courtauld Institute of Art in the United Kingdom. Her work focuses on the intersection of literature, politics, and society. Fatemeh is interested in the evolution of poetry and patronage in the Persian literary tradition and the representation and transformation of this relationship in modern Iran. She has published articles and book chapters on poetry, patronage, and politics in the Iranian context. Her book, A Revolution in Rhyme, Poetic Co-option Under the Islamic Republic, which has just come out fresh out of the oven in 2021, is concerned with Oxford University Press, is concerned with the question of poets and patrons in the past and present Iran. In her book, she demonstrates the role of state-sponsored literary institutions and ideological state apparatus in promoting state-sponsored literature in the post-revolutionary Iran. She has recently won the Humboldt Foundation Fellowship, congratulations, to join Forum Transregional Studies in Berlin in 2021 in order to embark on her second book project on exile and exile writing in Persian tradition. Fatemeh is also an internationally acclaimed award-winning poet and has so far published 3 collections of poetry in Persian and in English. Her first collection, 88 published in 2012, won the Jale Isfahani Poetry Award in London, UK. Her third bilingual collection, When They Broke Down the Door, published in 2015, translated by the world famous British literary scholar, translator and poet, Dick Davis, won Latife Yar Shater Book Award in 2016. Her poetry and her translations have been so far featured in the World Literature Today, Michigan Quarterly Review, Life and Legends, Poetry Foundation, Jacket 2, Penn Sound, and more. The upcoming Penguin Anthology of 1,000 Years of Poetry by Persian Women Poets, translated by Dick Davis, that has come out in 2021, has featured a number of her poems. Thank you, Dr. Shams, for joining us today. And without further ado, I hand over the table to you.
Thank you, Dr. Gahan. It's a pleasure to be here. I would like to thank you and Professor Tavakkoli Sarghi for such generous introductions and for really tirelessly organizing this remarkable series of lectures on cinema and women poets. I personally have learned a great deal. And it's an absolute pleasure and honor to be part of this this series. I would also like to thank all the participants. I can't see you, but I'm grateful that you made the time to be here. If that's okay, I'm going to share my slides, as everyone does these days. So the title of my talk, as you can see featured in here, is Women Poets, Gendered Personhood and Displacement. I would like to mention that what I'm going to read, which is an essay that I finished drafting particularly for this event, is part of a larger project, which is very much a work in progress. So ideas presented in this paper are not yet finalized and are subject to change. And that's why I am very much looking forward to your feedback on this paper. Since we are limited in terms of time, I'm going to read in the fashion that all the previous speakers have presented their work. I'm going to read my paper and then following some of the slides that I have put together. What is a woman poet? How is she created? And is a gendered nomenclature really necessary to distinguish her from her male counterparts? Women poets have long been systematically relegated to the margins of Persian literature. An attempt in the 18th century to assert women visibility led to the creation of a minor canon of women poetry, calibrated along phallocentric and heteronormative lines. This evolving categorization has been shaped ever since by ideas around physical beauty, marital carnality, sexual frustration, the fetishization of chastity or effat, and the punishment of sexual transgression. Have poetic patriarchal forces and values constructed this fictive womanhood? What is the relationship between a poet, their poetry, and the social power structures that define them? My presentation today will explore this problematic aspect of Persian literature with a particular focus on the 10th century poet Rabi'a Balkhi, the so-called mother of Persian poetry. It is important first, however, to acknowledge the temporal connotations of this topic, examining the ways in which women poets have been labeled and how they themselves respond to that labeling is inextricably linked to time. Feminist theorists such as Julia Kristeva have devoted much thought to time itself being a patriarchal structure. And whilst we don't have time to cover this today, it is worth noting how it influences the nomenclatures of women poets. Longitudinal studies must be rooted in a sense of linear time, history, chronology. And for this discussion today, the resources available to us are the result of an endemic male gaze in the literary canon that has inevitably shaped what we read, what is published, what is written, and by whom. As Sonal Sharma notes in his article, and I quote, "Women did not compile their own anthologies of poetry, and thus it remained, and to some extent still remains, a history and canon from a male point of view," end of quote. Sharma is talking specifically here about the Tazkirats, literary anthologies of poetry, prose, legends, and stories assembled over the centuries to chronicle the evolution of literary trends, in the history. While the Tazkirats remain a rich source for literary scholarship and analysis, but they are at heart skewed by male gaze of anthologists and commissioners involved in their creation. The Persian literary canon is born out of natural order of the court. For centuries, poets have occupied a royal, stately, or royal, stately, or in more recent times, political role in which those who were more visible in courtly life and the social order had a higher chance of being anthologized in the Tazkirats. Gender segregation and disproportion is a governing feature of the courtly milieu, a more or less sexually exclusive environment in which women's poetry, like their bodies, was barely visible. In the 18th century, a woman-only Tazkira was compiled, which was, as you can see here, Heravid's Jawaharul Ajoyeb, an indicator that towards the end of the Taymurid era, the situation slightly improved in favor of women poets. As the literary historian Maria Zub and others have argued, this improvement is particularly evident during the last significant Taymurid ruler of Herat, Sultan Hasan Boy Qara, a period which was critical in the birth of the category of women poets in the margins of an all-male canon. Although, as Sonal Sharma also asserts, most of the women poets in the anthology have no substantial over, and I quote, "and their names are merely records of the small but constant participation in the production of literature." Basically, women are invisible, as we were just discussing with Professor Tavakkoli Taqi. Their individuality and their identity is almost invisible in most of these categories. In short, it was a tokenistic attempt to make women more visible at a time when it would not have been possible for women to create a significant body of work without court employment or being paid for what they have written. It was, however, an important pin in the map of gendered poetic identity formation. Another pin can be placed more recently in the early 20th century, a time in which outspoken women like Furugha Farrokhzad and Simine Behbahani were undoubtedly plowing their own furrows in the literary landscape and directly responding to the imposition of a gendered nomenclature. Farrokhzad, arguably one of the most influential poets of the 20th century, could never escape questions about her gender in her work. In a well-known interview with Iraci Gergin, Farrokhzad was asked to elaborate on the femininity, or zanane budan, of her poetic output. She replied, and I quote, "If my poetry, as you mentioned, has a feminine quality, it naturally has to do with me being a woman. Fortunately, I'm a woman. But when it comes to the evaluation of artistic values, I believe that to speak of gender as a measuring criterion is irrelevant and inappropriate, unquote. Farrokhzad pushed for a move away from gendered thinking, declaring that, and I quote, the male/female binary is not worthy of any attention, unquote. She explained that the feminine aura of her work was not intentional, but rather unconscious, or nakhodagah, unfolding of her existence. As she concluded, and I quote, the most important thing is to be human. مهمترین چیز آدم بودنه. Farrokhzad's contemporary, the poet Simine Behbahani, voiced similar criticisms of gender categorization in an interview with Dunyay Sokhan that has been featured and translated by Professor Farzaneh Milani in her book, Words and Veils. And I quote this, cite this from Professor Milani's book. Behbahani says, and I quote, I suffer from this curtain that is drawn between men and women writers. If a poet is truly a poet, why should the issue of sex turn into privilege? The arena of poetry is no wrestling ring in which sex and weight are criteria for categorization, unquote. By dissociating sex and gender from the arena of poetry, or arsay shep, Behbahani invites readers and critics to move away from what feminist theorist Judith Butler describes as regulatory fictions that consolidate and naturalize the convergent power regimes of masculine and heterosexist oppression. As Farzaneh Milani notes, the rejection of gendered classification by these poets is underpinned by the, and I quote, implied concerns that placing women in a gendered marked category automatically downgrades their work to a subsection created especially for them, isolating women from the mainstream of Persian literature understood to belong to men is feared to be damaging, at best condescending to women, unquote. Farrokhzad's death in 1967 coincided with the global rise of feminist scholarship in which many of her and Behbahani's assertions would find a theoretical home. French feminist philosopher and linguist Lucie Rogari writes in her book, This Sex Which Is Not One, that woman, she writes in her book that women, and I quote, are women already, unquote. And for this reason, any definition or categorization of femininity imposed upon women by the patriarchy is to be confronted. Judith Butler takes a similar stance by resisting the arbitrary binary of femininity versus masculinity, employing instead the term gender, in which there are various gendered identities that are fluid, inclusive, and open to change, while the terms feminine and masculine are products of a phallocentric approach. And in this presentation, I use the word gender in the Butlerian sense that moves beyond biology and recognizes it as a social construct, a fiction that is mutable and unfixed. In other words, gendered classification is not neutral, free of judgment, or merely a way of ordering books on shelves. It is a pernicious statement of hierarchy, the result of a social party prey that consistently otherizes women. As we see in the words of poets themselves, gendered labeling serves to dilute or undermine female poetic output. In the case of medieval women poets, their lexicon is quickly dismissed as imitative and cliched by male critics who see their work as weak derivatives of the work of their male peers. Such critics castigate women poets for internalizing the masculine poetic lexicon, forgetting, of course, that language itself is a phallocentric domain, and to write is an almost Faustian pact with the symbolic order in Lacanian terms. And to this end, even non-subversive verse written by women poets is to be understood as a rupture in the language. Our discussion here so far has focused on how top-down decisions on poetic classification has shaped women as writers and women stepping into a male-dominated world and in which male gatekeepers control the system that that commission, publish, anthologize, review, and filter their poetic output. But there is a second and more subtle process at work here in how the women who do make it through the net and whose voice are heard and whose work is released into the world supply the clay with which society's perception of womanhood is shaped. To unpick this idea, I will focus on the 10th century poet Rabe'i Balkhi, who was given the title of the mother of Persian poetry alongside her male counterpart, Rudaki Samarkandi, the father of Persian poetry. What can, and I ask, what can her work tell us about the evolution of this category, women poets? And how did she conform to or transcend male hegemonic structures and thought and depictions? And how have perceptions of her changed over time? I will present and problematize the multiple gender identities that have constructed for and ascribed to Rabe'e as a woman poet before drawing on her own words to see how she perceived her own personhood. I would like to start with by just saying that Rabe'e as a trailblazer, as a poetic trailblazer, that why is she so important in the in Persian literature and why is it important to discuss Rabe'e if you're talking about women poets? First of all, she was never employed as a professional poet by the Samanid court. Very little of her poetry has survived. It is believed that most of her poetry has been destroyed by her brother Horace, who also killed her, as I will mention, and I will talk about that in a minute. And we know next to nothing about her life. In short, she is a historical enigma whose real and embodied personhood has been overtaken by myth, speculation, and appropriation. She has been constructed over the centuries into the Rabe'e that others needed her to be. And yet, without her, Persian poetry may not have been the same. As Dick Davis argues in the recently published anthologies, and I quote, as far as we know, Rabe'e is the first Persian poet to write macaronic verse. This is verse that is written in two languages, usually in alternating lines. In Rabe'e's case, the alternating lines are in Arabic and Persian. Dick Davis also reminds us that Rabe'e was not merely a woman who happened to write verse at a moment when Persian poetry was being reborn, but that her role in this survival was crucial and perhaps decisive. Her circumstances and achievements indicate that she was someone whose example made possible the revival of Persian poetry, at least in terms of its major non-Persian model. Her impact, however, remains underanalyzed, and her role as an originator whose work may have influenced her male counterpart is rarely appreciated. In his work, Elahé, the 12th and 13th century mystic poet Attar, records Rabe'e's exchanges with the male counterpart, her male counterpart poet Rudaki Samarkandi, who we consider to be the founder of Persian poetry. It shows that Attar's text basically shows that it was in fact Rudaki who had been moved to memorize her verse. Not the way around, and recited before his patrons, including Rabe'e's brother Horace. This is part of Elahinamen. I read it in Persian, and the English translation is available for those of you who don't read Persian. Magar az Rudaki shah she'r darkhast, zaban bokshad an ustad u barkhast, cho budash yad she'r dokhtar ka'b, همه برخاند و مجلس گرم شد صعب. شهش گفتا بگو تا این که گفته است که مروارید را ماند که صفت است. ز سرمستی زبان بگشاد آنگاه که شعر دختر کعب است ای شاه. According to Attar, the king in this scene is Haris, Rabe'a's brother, who through Rudaki's recitation finds out about Rabe'a's secret love affair with a servant named Baktash. And Attar also recounts the story of Rabe'a's murder in the hands of her brother. It's one of the her murder is the earliest, one of the earliest cases, at least, if not the earliest case of honor killing also in the Persian literary tradition. So Haris basically slit her veins, in some versions, her throat, after discovering her affair. In Attar's version of the story, she was left in the bathhouse and bled to death. Baktash killed Haris in revenge, and then committed suicide on Rabe's grave. Her death has heavily influenced the posthumous construction of her life. The two famous masnavis depicting the tragedy include a section of Attar's Elahiname, as I mentioned, and also Golestan-e-Iram by Reza Qoli Khan Hedayat, 19th century poet and literati. He also mentions this in Majma'ul Fusaha. He also references this story in Majma'ul Fusaha. But my question here is that how else has she been, other than, you know, that what we know about the circulation of her poetry in the courts at the time and the fact that she was memorized and read, recited by Rudaki, this is one way to remember her. And but how has her legacy manipulated and mythologized her actual personhood that I will get to at the end of this presentation? I will start with the non-mystical Rabe'a. Well, I'm not there yet, but to say that Tazkiras over centuries have presented Rabe'a's name in the Persian canon, and I borrow this phrase, non-mystical Rabe'a, from Sonal Sharma's article, who actually mentions this. And he mentions also that the Rabe'a was integrated into the mainstream tradition of women poet at an early date as a non-mystical figure, although he doesn't mention what that early date is. I will argue here that in fact, it was first her mystical depiction that happened before this non-mystical depiction. And I will get into that in a minute. But it's important to know here that Sharma's use of the term non-mystical becomes the starting point of my analysis of the splintering and reshaping and co-option of Rabe'a by different groups and literary trends. As we shall see shortly, I will get to this, as we shall see shortly, how the 11th century Sufi Abu Sa'id Abu Khair claimed her as the first one to claim her as a mystic, in fact. But in Ufiz Lebab al-Albab, the portrayal of Rabe'a is somewhat different, as you can see in here. In all historical accounts, one thing that all of these accounts, in fact, share is that they introduce Rabe'a first and foremost as the daughter of Ka'b, Rabe'a bint Ka'b. And this is curious. This curious obsession with Rabe'a's lineage is not necessarily the case in for other women poets. We don't have it for Mahasti Ganjavi, we don't have it for Padishah Khatun, and so forth. But it's interesting why Rabe'a is actually introduced in this fashion. So Ofi describes Rabe'a as follows. Rabe'a bint Ka'b Ghazdari, dokhtar Ka'b, agar che zan bood, amma be fazl bar mardan jahan bekhandidi, faris har do meydan va vali har do bayan, bar nazm tazi qader va dar she'r parsi be qayat mahir, va ba qayat zeka' khater va hiddat ta' peyvaste ishq bakhti va shahid bazi kardi. The opening conjunction, although, is very revealing here. Rabe'a was accomplished, intelligent, and high achieving in spite of her womanhood. Her success in the male world is swiftly undercut by the reminder that she is a mere woman after all, a coquettish, flirtatious, unmoraled woman that we see in here as in her depiction, the boy chaser as translated by Sharma. And this male gaze sexualizes her as if the two descriptions of her being an intelligent woman and a flirtatious cancel each other out. This first construction of Robert's womanhood points to the Cartesian split in the mindsets of male critics and commentators, that a woman is either a body or a mind, but cannot be both. Similar woman poets have been subjected to the same critic. Amine Etesami, writing centuries later after Rabe, is an example that's cited by Farzaneh Milani. And I quote, the reality of a talented, prolific woman poet being shocking, too disorienting to the society without any such previous experience, unquote. The male poets in office taskara are given full biographies too, but without any reference to their morals, to their sexual desires based on their gender. And the question is that why did Rabe's love life and sexual desire matter so much to Ophi? This gendered narrative revolving around the biographical details of women poets' life continues to this day, and women poets still suffer the same fate. Apologies. Despite Farrokhzad's prolific contribution to the Persian canon, critics are still hung up on her biography. Who washed her corpse when she died? How many lovers did she have? Was she legally married or not? The current leader of the Islamic Republic has spent 3 decades of his life trying to preach about whether she was ultimately damned or saved. His tokenistic appraisal of Parvin Etesami as a more pious and chaste poetess than Furugh-e Farrokhzad is a prime example of a gendered canonization of women poets by a politician after the Islamic Republic. Like Rabe'e, Furugh's early death at age 32 created a battleground for generations to come. And to be a woman poet is to open your body. And this is what I want to basically say. This is the core of my argument, is that to be a woman poet is to open your body and your life to scrutiny. To be a woman poet is to occupy a dangerous and moralized state. And now I get to the depiction of Rabe as a mystical woman, as a mystical Sufi, mystical figure. Rabe's mystical identity was first constructed in Sufi anecdotes of Abu Sa'id al-Khair, 11th century mystic, who draws on the general content of her poetry and apparently the biography that he heard to present her as a mystic. We read in his work, من این جانب رسیدم و از حال دختر کعب پرسیدم که عارف بوده است یا عاشق. جواب دادند اشعاری که بر زبان او جاری بوده دلیل این است که در عشق مجازی ایجاد اینقدر سوز و گداز ممکن نیست. در شعر او اصلا حظ وجود ندارد بلکه در همه جا او خدا را ذات قدیم یا جل شأن او خطاب کرده است. Abu Sa'id al-Khair's construction of Rabe is curious in the sense that there is a defensive tone, as you can see in Abu Sa'id al-Khair, that alludes to the fact that Rabe is that Rabe up to this point had essentially been a shamed woman, conducting an improper affair whose wrongdoings were punished by an honor killing. And then the question then becomes, why did Abu Sa'id al-Khair seek to cleanse her memory and resurrect her as a saint, or to lift her out of the shame of being a lover and bringing her into the light of being a mystic? Was this an attempt to protect her honor and to reimagine her as a chaste woman? Or was he simply trying to defend her against the religious fanatics of the time, Some have speculated that he might have said this simply to protect his her dead body from the assault of the fanatics. We don't know. But what we know is that Abu Sa'id al-Khair's anecdote was later recounted by two major Sufi poets, Fariduddin Attar and Abdurrahman Jami. Between them, the three poets remade Rabi'a into an intelligible Sufi woman for whom certain kinds of identities, such as a lover, were incongruous. They allegorized her love affair to allow her to float unscathed into the purity of a mystic life. Abdurrahman Jami in his Nafahat al-Uns officially names Rabi'a or categorizes Rabi'a in the list of Sufi women. Sheikh Sa'id Abul, and all of these are based on basically drawing on Abu Sa'id al-Khair's words. Sheikh Abu Sa'id al-Khair قدس الله تعالی سره گفته است که دختر کعب عاشق بود بر آن غلام اما پیران همه اتفاق کردند که این سخن که او میگوید نه آن سخن باشد که بر مخلوق توان گفت او را جای دیگر کار افتاده بود روزی آن غلام آن دختر را ناگاه دریافت سر آستین وی گرفت دختر بانگ بر غلام زد و گفت تو را این بس نیست که من با خداوندم آنجا مبتلایم بر تو بیرون دادم که طمع میکنی شیخ ابو سعید گفت سخنی که او گفته است نه چنان است که کسی را در مخلوق افتاده باشد and then we can see that very clearly Abdurrahman Jami is rephrasing Rabi'a's conversation with her servant by drawing on Attar's Elahiname, which is these lines basically. چنین گفتو که معلومم چنان شد که آن معنی که بر لفظش روان شد ز سوز عشق معشوق مجازی به نک شاید چنین شعری به بازی نداشتان شعر با معشوق کاری که او را بود با حق روزگاری کمالی بود در معنی تمامش بهانه آمده در ره غلامش. Both Jami's and Attar's accounts are an intertextual rendition of their Sufi master Abu Sa'id al-Khair's brief anecdote with an emphasis on Rabi'a's inherent piety. Mystic poets were masters of transforming ordinary love into an allegory for divine love to advocate their own cause. And Rabi'a was not the only woman to be canonized by Sufi poets. In his Tafsirat al-Awliya, Memories of the Saint, Attar cloaked the 8th century Sufi woman, Rabi'a al-Adawiyya, in a veil of chastity and sincerity, as you can read in here. An masture setre ikhlas, an sukhte ishq o ishtiyaq, an shifte qurb o ihtiraq, an gumshode visal, an maqbul rijal saniye, Maryam safiye, Rabi'a al-Adawiyya rahmatullah alayha. اگر کسی گوید ذکر او در صف رجال چرا کرده ای گویم که خواجه انبیا علیه السلام می فرماید ان الله لا ينظر الى صوركم الحديث کار به صورت نیست به نیت است چون زن در راه خدای مرد بود او را زن نتوان گفت. In Attar's words, woman's saintly status is measured by her chastity, quote-unquote, also virginity, but with reference to Saint Mary, and in reference her approval by the male gaze, the maqbul al-rijal, and her womanhood must be first vetted before she can join the ranks of the mystics, and to label her as a saint at the end, she must be de-womanized and metamorphosized into a man. Quite linguistically, like, and literally. And this is basically my point of departure to see now that to move on from these receptions of Rabi'a, depictions of Rabi'a, to her own words, it's important to remember that she was not a self-proclaimed Sufi and that there is no historical evidence that confirms that that confirms her ties with any Sufi order. And to put it simply, she was just a woman, basically, who wrote poems and fell in love. Now, the last part of my talk is about Rabi'a in her own words. And the questions are, how did Rabi'a construct her own gender identity? And what answers do her remaining words contain with regards to this question? How did she, as Helen Sixon's Sixus's words, to put it in her word, in her famous work, Love of Medusa, how did Rabi'a put herself into text and as into the world and as into the history by her own movement? The purpose of Rabi'a's poetry, as I mentioned, is extremely scant. The small number of lyrical poems available to us show an entanglement with the pains and pleasures of love at their core. Since the Persian language lacks gender markers, Rabi'a's beloved, like many other poets' beloved, remains obscure in terms of sex. But from the tone and linguistic references of her poems, it becomes clear that she's talking about a raw and real human, not a divine love. And this is one of the examples of her poems that I'm going to talk about. دعوت من بر تو آن شد کیزدت عاشق کناد بر یکی سنگین دلی نامهربان چون خیشتن تا بدانی درد عشق و داغ مهر و غم خوری تا به هجران در بپیچی و بدانی قدر من. In a poetic tradition characterized by the exaltation of the beloved at any cost, cursing the beloved is a bold and subversive move. This is also a poem about revenge, turning what should be a prayer into a curse. It is raw and embodied, seething with real feeling. It is the writing of a woman with a body and a mind. By reversing the position of the lover and the beloved, Rabi'a subverts the traditional transaction of love in Perso-Arabic writing, where the beloved is constantly placed in a higher position. Loathing the beloved became a more common trope in the 15th century among the Wasukht poets from Wuku school of poetry. Other poets such as Sa'di Shirazi, Amir Khosrow Dehlavi, and Bahshi Bafi occasionally wrote poems of this kind later after Rabi'a. Again, seeing this Wasukht style in Rabi'a's work confirms her place as a poetic pioneer and a bold and unflinching voice in the canon, starting what became a school centuries later in short lyrics that have survived from her, I think shows the originality of her voice and her work. Rabi'a, in this short poem, refuses to beg, mourn, compromise, or pursue. She breaks and leaves. In the eighth chapter of her book, Living a Feminist Life, the feminist and queer writer of color, Sara Ahmad, defines the feminist snap as a sudden break, this happens when the woman reaches a breaking point that she cannot accept. To snap is to speak up, to take action, to refuse to accept unacceptable interactions. Rabi'a speaks up, takes action, refuses the unacceptable behavior of her beloved, all in this one short poem. And this is not really, as you can see, the voice of a mystic or a shallow coquette. This is the voice of a real lover taking responsibility and holding the beloved accountable. In another short poem, Rabi'a celebrates the physical reunion with her beloved. Mastam be vesal dost dilshad emshab. و از مهنت و از غم شده آزادم شد. با دوست نشستم همین میگویم یا رب که کلید صبح گم باد امشب. This poem takes place behind the closed doors of the night and in the beloved's physical presence. Physical reunion in a dark night erotizes the love affair, and there is no reference to a place or a location where this reunion takes place, which adds to its secretive quality and perhaps a spatial precarity too. It is night, and as she is seated by her lover's side, Rabe speaks to God and asks for a miracle to make the key to the morning disappear. Speaking with God, face to face, in the darkness of the night, this is a prophetic, by the way, image in a prophetic tradition that women had no place. And Rabe has this recurrently in her poetry, talking face to face to God, body to body with the beloved. These are all subversive gender identities that Rabe is constructing for herself. The erotic referentiality of the image codes throw light on the poet's gender identity as a lover in that dichotomy that Abu Sa'id Abul Khair created. Is she a lover or a mystic? She's clearly a lover in here, who first invites the gaze, only to forbid its entry until the arrival of the morning. Again, there is nothing mystical or superficial about this poem. And the last poem by Rabe that I'm discussing is her most well-known and frequently referenced poem, which is a short lyric poem about love, which recounts the poet's personal experience of falling in love and facing its afflictions. عشق او باز اندر آوردم به بند، کوشش بسیار نامد سودمند. عشق دریایی کران ناپدید، کی توان کردن شنا ای هوشمند. عشق را خواهی که تا پایان بری، بس که بپسندید باید ناپسند. زشت باید دید و انگارید خوب، زهر باید خورد و انگارید قند. توسنی کردم ندانستم همی کس کشیدن تنگتر آید کمند. Rabe is the pioneering figure in coining the metaphorization of love as a shoreless sea as referenced in this poem, which later became one of the central metaphors of mystical literature with frequent appearances in the poetry of Sana'i, Attar, Molavi, and Hafez. Rabe is the first one, the first poet in the whole tradition creating this metaphor, which then becomes a key metaphor in mystical literature. This is another example where we can see Rabe pioneers in shaping the poetic lexicon that is usually understood to be a masculine lexicon and becomes the model of emulation in her own right. She also leads the way in defining the lover's duties in the face of upheavals, a role that was later reserved for the masters of a didactical Sufi literature, all male. And that duty is to act against one's desire in search of the truth. This became the pinnacle of mystical literature throughout 12th and 13th century. Rabe planted the seeds of this all-consuming type of love also, and single-handedly set the tone for an emerging all-male mystical tradition whose main subject was nothing but reconceptualization of love. The ending lines of the poem, however, are key in characterization of this love. She reappears at the end of the poem in the body of an untamed wild horse, as the vahshi, tosani kardan. Or to behave, and tosani kardan in Persian as a verb means to behave, have an unruly behavior or rebellious behavior. In this context, or it could be also rebellious, unruly, and also raw, and you know, not that well thought. But in this context, it is a reference to acts of transgression in love, as a result of which the speaker has reached a point of no return, which is basically her own death. This is also a poem that rumors, and that we have nothing to actually really confirm this, but they said that it has been also said that this is the last poem that she wrote with her own blood on the walls of the bathhouse. But we, as I said, historically, we can't really prove this. But what is important is that the confessional tone of this last line of the poem reifies the abstract conceptualization of love in the previous lines. Transgression itself is the core of this poem. In constructing her own gender, Rabia depicts herself as a rebellious lover who has violated the rules and conventions of the social order regardless of its outcome. And of course, she has found herself in a position of no return. Now, Furugh Farrokhzad's poem, I want to go centuries later. Furugh Farrokhzad's well-known poem, confessional poem also, and this is interesting, this confessional voice that we hear from many poems written by women throughout the history. The poem Sin or Gunah, written some thousands years later, is the continuation of the same act of transgression. That's my point in here, basically, that albeit it reveals itself in a much more erotic, personified, poetic language, and also personification of the sort of corporeality of the beloved. Now, if Rabia forged the path of transgressive love, Furugh carried that path to fruition, by expanding the semiotic language to write against the abjection of the feminine and corporeality of her love affair. The poems both are about love affairs. Years after Furugh and Simin, and this is the last part of my talk, I apologize for the length of this presentation. Years after Rabia, Furugh and Simin, women poets continue to depict women's gender displacement in unprecedented ways. The following poem, titled A Full-Time Position, Kar Tamam Vaqt, by Sara Mohammadi Ardahali, born in 1976, is a prime example of such poetry. هیچ مردی نمیخواهد عاشق زنی شود که در سیرک کار میکند. از آن زنها که باید روی تناب راه بروند. عاشق زنی شود که هر لحظه ممکن است سقوط کند و اگر سقوط نکند هزارها نفر برایش کف میزنند. Stuck on a tight rope, the woman continues to exist and perform in the most precarious position under the envious gaze of the patriarchy. She is too proficient and visible to be loved. She is that rare female species that Ophi would not expect to exist. Mohammadi Ardahali masterfully depicts woman's gendered personhood and displacement in a patriarchal economy, where even a full-time position for women comes with its own risks and problems. And my conclusion here. So what is a woman poet? A woman who writes, who breaks through patriarchal structures to be published and read. The genre of women poets then is united by this definition, but also by much, much more. Those who find themselves in the category of women poets have been forced to accept a Faustian pact in which, in exchange for their words, they give up control over how their bodies and biographies are perceived. They enter into the canon in which they can either have minds and be elevated into mysticism, or bodies and be fetishized as lustful boy chasers. The label woman poet does not enable the writer to be either fully woman or fully poet. Instead, they're consigned to a judgmental half-life in which their human actions and creative output merge and undermine one another. Their identities are constructed, enforced, displaced through the signifying practices of the paternal economy in Lacanian terms. If we agree with Lacan that the ontological signification of being is determined by a language structured by the paternal law and its mechanisms of differentiation, the canonization of a woman poet in one way or the other makes her the displaced other of a heterosexualized masculine desire, as well as the representation and reflection of that desire. To find new ways in understanding, reading, theorizing women poets, we must need to plant seeds of doubt in their representations and canonization as the first step to move away from rigid binary classifications whose only outcome is to further marginalization of women's writing as a minor category. Women's poetry can only exist as a meaningful category if it isn't considered as a self-evident binary that constantly positions itself vis-a-vis male poetry in order to exist. If we accept Butler's conceptualization of gender as an evolving construct beyond the feminine-masculine binary, we must begin to explore the gendering process by reading their own poems through a theoretical lens. In rereading Rabe's poems, we can trace a dynamic gender identity that shines through her transgressive approach to the physicality of love without fetishization of a gendered body. We can observe how she constructs her own gender through performativity. She constantly writes herself into language, either face to face with God or body to body with the beloved, or places herself in an insubordinate, defiant position of a lover that disrupts any form of passivity, absence, and abjection in the social order. Definitions and delineations, reductionist as they may be, can be useful. They can supply the much needed remedy to entrench invisibility of the unheard and unseen. The tokenistic and misleading generalization of Persian literary canon has so far been unhelpful in my view, but it is progress that more women are being published and known and anthologized, of course. That contemporary voices are increasingly able to defend, reject, and speak out on the labels that they're given in their own voice. We are a long way from Farrokhzad's belief that the most important thing is to be a human. But as writers, as anthologizers, as commissioners, as academics, as theorists, we have the opportunity now to begin to correct that balance. And the very end of my talk, I would like to end my talk with a poem that I wrote in the memory of Rabe'a years ago. And then that's that. و کبوترها رابعه. کبوترها دیگر به شانه های من اعتماد ندارند. دیروز یک نفر ناگهان مرد. شانه هایم لرزیدند و کبوترها به گمان زلزله از آشیانه گریختند. امشب مثل یک شهر خالی با خودم تنها ماندم. دانه پاشیدم شاید برگشتند. And this is a poem from the 88 collection, my first collection, and written for the doves that are actually flying around her shrine, apparently, in Balkh. Thank you.